Hi, Larry here with Summit Imaging and Ultrasound and Mammography Equipment Support Organization, and we have our special guest, Carolyn.
Hi, I'm Carolyn Coffin. I'm an ergonomics consultant with Sound Ergonomics and a sonography professor.
Well, thanks for joining us again. Carolyn gives us so much great information from, you know, a particular perspective from, you know, not only being from the clinical side, but, you know, actually training, you know, hundreds or thousands of students on sonography over the years and, you know, yeah, having just an incredible reputation.
And so, your technicians.
Yes, and our technicians. So that's why she's here, is because she, you know, gives us so much insight into, you know, an image that, you know, is inherently blurry, and we need to understand what's good blurry and what's not good blurry and how to get rid of it to see what we're trying to find. And, you know, it's a hard art, you know, when it comes to the imaging mm-hmm. space. So
it can be.
Yeah. Today we wanted to ask about, you know, particularly a convex probe that had come in and, you know, a lot of color noise and, you know, kind of being, you know, obviously the obvious section here, but, you know, just these also these artifacts and these spikes of color kind of across the entire crystal here. Wanted your, you know, your take on, you know, the impact of the patient, number one, from an image quality perspective, and then number two, you know, how it impacts the, you know, the sonographer that's mm-hmm. actually capturing this image.
Well, this is an interesting image, and I'm just curious as to how long it took the facility to really identify this as a transducer problem and send it in for repair. But I can see where somebody would be struggling with this image, trying to figure out why we're getting this kind of mosaic pattern in the color, which usually is a result of what we call aliasing, which is the velocity scale being too low for the velocities being represented here. So that would be your first thought as a sonographer. It's like, why is this velocity so high? When in fact, it's really related to a damaged crystal. Unfortunately, I don't think enough sonographers know enough about transducer damage and transducer created artifacts, and will struggle with this for a long part of the exam, trying to reposition the transducer or the incident angle, trying to figure out if the velocity scale is the issue, moving around, looking for a better window, and in reality, it's really the transducer itself. But as a sonographer, those aren't things that we know inherently that we identify. So we tend to go with what we know from a physics standpoint rather than a mechanical standpoint. The impact of this for the patient is, first of all, there's a loss of good information. There's a loss of the ability to image of the vessel and blood flow appropriately, or the possibility that it would be identified as a tight lesion of stenosis and incorrectly diagnosed as a high velocity. It's also an issue because if this image is submitted for review by a physician and it's determined that maybe there's something wrong with either the approach to the image or the transducer, then the whole exam have to be repeated. That brings the patient back in for another exam and it charges the insurance company again.
Wow. So I think the assumption that we can't make anymore is that the transducer could be the issue when the sonographer may assume that the transducer is fine.
Mm-hmm.
And then it creates a workflow that must be repeated because the transducer prevented the correct diagnostics and imaging in the first place.
Yes.
So doesn't that like significantly increase total cost of ownership for a healthcare facility?
Oh yeah, absolutely, because the exam has to be repeated, the sonographer's time is of value. And then you lose the transducer because now it goes back for repair. And this looks like a pretty extensive repair, am I right?
Yeah, this would be an extensive repair. You know, not impossible to repair, but this is significantly damaged. And if you look at the technical pieces, you can see that these color artifacts are an issue. And there's actually more damage than just the color here. And so this is something that Carolyn's helped us identify. But you can see there's actually drops here.
In the image.
And what that's telling us is that the drops that aren't exhibiting color are actually circuits that are now open when they should be shorted the entire time. And so these noisy color artifacts that you see here, actually a significant amount of it, is either circuits that are intermittently, constantly touching like this, or the crystal is just not sending the wrong information. It's off timing because it's been cracked some way, somehow, and then it's just kind of speckling out here. So it can happen in several areas. So this probe, you know, has had a rough life, to be very PC about it, but you can see in the background, there's actually more damage than just the obvious color noise that we're seeing here. So if you kind of look at, you know, how many channels there are, I would say a good third of the channels are damaged and probably would not not be worth repairing for a customer, because that would take a lot of time because not all of them are going to be line damaged. Some of them could be crystal. Some of them could be the flex going into the crystal. But this transducer has been through a lot. And
I just wonder if it was a gradual degradation, if maybe had it been identified by the user early, if it could have been sent in quickly and repaired more easily.
You know, this is just purely speculation. Yeah. So this is our experience in working with healthcare facilities. When we see significant damage like this, this actually occurs over time. Mm-hmm. And it's something as simple as putting the transducer into maybe a storage container, like a Tupperware bin, which could be procedure, but the person putting it into the Tupperware just drops it. Or they put it in there gently, but then when they walk around, they sway when they walk, and then the connector starts hitting the probe. And then every time it hits the head of the probe, you get one of these drops. And then you get the next one after it hits the next one. And you do that for a few months, then yeah, you have, you know, this as the result. And so there's a lot of ways that these probes get damaged, and you know, it's different. You know, we're all humans and we all do things a little bit differently. And we're just finding when we go from facility to facility to help reduce the damage of these probes that they are, you know, for the most part, a lot of them have some very unique issues that they're doing because they're just inherently different depending on the size of the customer or a healthcare facility, depending on, you know, if they're new technicians that are working in the sterilization department or if they've been there for a while. There's a lot of variables involved and, you know, we're able to step in there and help. So. Carolyn, thank you so much again for coming in today and talking to us about, you know, these image quality issues here. And, you know, please, you know, subscribe to our YouTube channel. We got more videos coming. Please like us on Facebook, follow us on LinkedIn. And until next time, thanks for watching.